Hello and welcome. Today we're going to talk about the time value of money and how we can move single cash flows back and forth in time. My name is Johan Kassel. So on today's agenda, we're going to talk a little bit about financial decisions and what they are. We're then going to talk about the concept of time value of money and why we say that there is such a thing. We're then going to talk about how we can move a cash flow from today until a period somewhere in the future. And we're also going to talk about how we can compute the present value of cash flow, which means we take it from the future and back again. So what do we mean when we talk about making an investment? Well, usually you think about giving up resources today. Perhaps we spend a lot of money on buying a machine, and then we hope that it will give something back in the future. So when we purchase a machine, we hope that it will enhance our production so we can produce more goods to sell. But also, for example, when you're looking at this video, you're spending time now in the hope of understanding this course or concepts better in the future. And we also have this thing called a timeline, which then represents, so we have time as here, so we have 1, 2, 3, and 4, etc. It represents years or months, but this means that it's one period into the future, two periods in the future, three periods in the future, etc. Then we have something here, which we call cash flows. And then when we have an arrow going up, it means that it's a positive cash flow. And when we have an arrow going down, it means it's a negative cash flow. So in this case, it's a negative cash flow of 300. We always talk about net cash flows. So that's like the important thing. because we don't, usually we each year we take the cash flows in and the cash flows out and we just net them. And then what we're interested in is how much money have we actually got in. So we talk about net cash flows. And this investment in the beginning, which we usually have in most examples, we call that an initial investment. Okay, so if we go to financial decisions, we always consider net cash flows. We always consider net cash flows. And we want it to be in comparable terms. So for example, we don't want to compare investment in a building to an investment in, for example, well, this study time. I mean, it would be hard to compare investing 100 million in a machine compared to spending 100 hours on listening to me chatting in this video. So we want it to be in comparable terms. And that is why we talk about something called a time value of money. So in all of these videos that you're going to watch here, we're going to assume that money received today is worth more than money received tomorrow. So when we talk about comparable terms, we cannot compare money $100 today to $100 received in 5 years. And why do we say that? I mean, it might not seem so straightforward, but we basically have three different reasons for this. First of all, we have something called inflation, which means that prices generally increase. So if you want to buy something in 5 years' time, 100 kroner won't buy as much as 100 kroner will today. So money lose value in that sense. Then we also usually have something called that you can gain interest. So let's say that I have money today that I don't want to use, then I can deposit it in a bank account and they will pay some interest rate, maybe very low right now, but at least some interest rate. So in 1 year's time, I can take out more than 100 kroner. So 100 kroner today can grow into the future and therefore it's better to have it now than later. And lastly, there's always this kind of uncertainty. Let's say that I have a friend who promises me that he will give me 100 crowns in 5 years. Can I really trust that? Will I actually receive that money, or is there maybe some risk to it? So these are three reasons why we assume that money today is worth more than money tomorrow. Okay, so to take an actual example of this, let's say that I have 5,000 SEK today and I want to deposit it in a bank account for 4 years. How much money will I have if the annual interest rate is 2.2%? Okay, so how can we solve such a question? Well, let's say that I deposit 5,000 today, and if I get an interest rate of 2.2%, that means that I will receive, let's see, what will this be? This will be 11 crowns. No. It's 110 crowns in an interest payment for the next year. So after 1 year, I will receive 110 crowns. That means that in total, after 1 year, I will have 5,000 plus 110 equals to 5,110 crowns. Okay, so that's in 1 year. And in general, you can write this as you have 5,000 crowns, and it will grow by a factor of 1 plus an interest rate r. So this then, the r here is the interest rate. And that's for a single year. If you have it for several years, then you would have a factor k here. So it would mean that you would take it to the power of k. It basically means that it would be compounded by this factor 1 plus r several times. So in our example, this would be 5,000 times 1.022 to the power of 4. And this is equal to 5,400 and, oh, sorry, that was very ugly. 5,454.7. Okay, so what this means then is that if we deposit 5,000 today at an annual interest rate of 2.2% and we let it stay in the bank account for 4 years, then it will grow up until 5,454.7 kronor within 4 years. So again, we see an example that having the money now, 5,000, is worth more in 4 years than if we would receive 5,000 in 4 years. Right, so we're taking this example. In general then, you have a future value, then you take a present value today, so this is called a cash flow, the C. You take it times 1 plus the interest rate r to the power of n. So I used k the last time, but it doesn't really matter. It's just this number to the power here, it represents, this is how many years we want to move it into the future. So years into the future. Okay, and r then was the interest rate. And c is our cash flow, or the money we have today that we want to move. We will usually use FV to denote the future value when we talk about this. And in our example then, we had this 5,000 times 1 plus the interest rate of 2.2%. Oh, sorry. To the power of 4, which was then how many years into the future we wanted to move it. So that's basically how you do when you want to take money from a period today and move it some periods into the future. And you can choose any time period you want. It can be 20 years or 50 years. It doesn't really matter. You still employ this fairly simple formula. Okay. So let's take another example then. Now you have just become a parent and you wish to deposit some money in the bank, and you wish to deposit an amount large enough that your daughter can receive 100,000 SEK as a gift on the day she turns 18. If we assume that the bank can guarantee you an annual interest rate of 4.1%, then how much would you have to deposit today so that you have 100,000 within 18 years? Okay, so in this case, we actually know the future value. We want to have 100,000. But other than that, it looks pretty much the same. We have an interest rate of 4.10 and we have a period of 18 years. So we had this formula that the future value was equal to the cash today times 1 plus r to the power of n. All right, but what do we know then? So when you're doing math and you have some exercise that you cannot solve, well, let's use what you already know. We know the future value. It was 100,000 that we want then. We don't know how much cash we need today, so that's what we're trying to find, the C. And then we know the interest rate, it was 4.10%. And we also know the period, it was 18 years. Okay, so this is a fairly easy equation that we could solve. We only want to find this unknown variable C. So how do we solve it then? Well, what we're going to do is that we're going to divide both sides by this parenthesis. So we divide it by 1 plus 0.041 to the power of 18. And if you do it on both sides, you can do pretty much whatever you want in mathematics. 0.41. Okay, so it's a little bit messy, I apologize for that. But when you have this on the right-hand side, you have this parenthesis on top and on the bottom, then you can cancel them out. So now what you would have is only the C on the right hand side, and on the left hand side you have 100,000 divided by 1 plus 0.041 to the power of 18. Okay, and that means that we have a way of calculating the value today. So let's see what that is. It turns out that today we need to deposit 48,000, so this is a 4, 516.2 kronor in order for it to grow to a total of 100,000 in 18 years' time. So we need to deposit less than the sum that we need in the future because we get this interest payment every year. And the formula then, we actually derived it during that exercise, but when you want a present value, you take a future value, so in this case the C stands for a future value, and you divide it by 1 plus R to the power of N. So it's very similar to the future value calculation. This C then, in this case, it corresponds to the future value that we want to know. The R is again the interest rate. And the N is the number of periods or number of years in this time. So they are very similar. And actually, the only thing that you would do to go back and forth in time is that when you wanted a future value, you took the present value times this 1 plus R to the power of N. When you want the present value from a future value, you instead take the future value and divide it by 1 plus R to the power of N. So it's basically the same equation, and we just move this 1 plus R up so it's a multiplication, or down so it's division, depending on whether we want to go into the future or back from the future again. And just as with future value, we use a present value, something short for present value, which is PV. And then in our example, we had that this was 100,000 divided by 1 plus the interest rate to the power of 18. And we found that it was 48,516. Okay, so how do you know we know what interest rate is the correct one? Well, honestly, that's way beyond the level of this video, but an interest rate should reflect at least inflation, which we talked about in the beginning, and it should also reflect other investment opportunities. So if we have something else which we could invest the money in instead, then the interest rate should reflect that we have some opportunity cost that we miss if we do this investment. And finally, we would like it to also reflect the risk of the project. So a riskier project, maybe we want more return as a compensation, whereas a less risky project, maybe we don't need so much return. Okay, so there are some different names for this interest rate that we calculate with. Sometimes we use discount rate, sometimes we use the cost of capital, and sometimes we might use something called the hurdle rate. So these are all, they basically mean the same thing. It's the interest rate that we use in our calculations. Okay, so let's take one final example then. So one of your old study buddies offers you an investment opportunity. The investment requires that you give him 24.2 million kronor today, and then you are guaranteed to receive 27.2 million kronor in 2 years' time. And we need to compute the net present value of accepting his offer if the annual risk-free rate is 5%. So in this case, the important words here are that we need to compute the present value and of accepting his offer, and we also need to know that it's a net present value. So that means that we take the value that we receive in the future, we move it back today, and we compare it with the cost, which is then of 24.2 million today. Okay, so we have something called an initial outlay or initial investment, which was then this cost today. We have a future cash flow of 27 million, which is risk-free in this case. And that's, since it's risk-free, we use the risk-free rate as well. And then the period is 2 years. Okay, so this is just a present value calculation. So what was the formula? Well, we said that the present value, then you took the future cash flow with cos C and divide it by 1 plus R to the power of N, and N was then the period. So in this case, we want to know the present value of this future cash flow. So we take 27, we divide it by 1 plus the interest rate, which was 5%, can we take it to the power 2 because it was 2 years? And if we do that, we will find that this is 24.49 if we round it to 2 decimals. Okay, so now we wish to compare this sum, which is the positive cash flow, with the initial cost. And then we compute something called the net present value, which is then we take the positive one, 24.49, minus the negative one of 24.2. And we find that we actually gain here, and the gain is 0.29 million SEK. Okay, so what does that mean then? Well, it means that if we take this, make this investment, we will get more money than we would have received otherwise if we simply invested this 24.2 million at the risk-free rate of 5% and kept it for 2 years. So it's better to do this investment than to just keep the money and invest it at something else which is risk-free. Okay, so short summary then, we had this timeline. So we had a timeline like this, where we had some cash flows down in the beginning and some cash flows up later, usually. And it's very important to draw timelines like this because it makes it easy to see when do we receive cash flows, when are they negative, when are they positive, and how big are they. So it's a very good way to get an overview. And I strongly suggest that you always make one of these timelines when you try to solve exercises. And we also discussed the concept of time value money, and we said that money is worth more today than the same amount is in the future. We also talked about the discount rate, or the cost of capital, or the hurdle rate, or any other names that we might use, which is then the interest rate that we adjust this time value of money for. So sometimes we have a very high interest rate because we think that money today is worth a lot more than maybe money in the future, and sometimes we don't have such a high interest rate. We also said that the cash flows are what's important, and we always focus on net cash flows, although we might not say it explicitly. We learn how to compute the future value of a cash flow, and we also learn how to compute the present value of a cash flow. All right, so that's everything for today. I hope it helps, and I'll see you in a later video. Thank you.